Thank you very much for giving us your valuable time today. My name is Vincent O'Brien from ICC Banking Commission Market Intelligence Group, and it's my third time actually coming here to Jordan. And every time I come, I like coming back because one incredible natural resource you have clearly is your people, young, friendly, energetic, and willing to be open and to participate. So what I'm going to do is take a little bit of your time to give you the results of the ICC Global Trade Finance Survey 2012. This survey was only released last week, so the information actually is very, very current and very, very much up to date. And everyone will be getting a soft copy of the survey afterwards. What is the survey about, the ICC Global Trade Finance Survey? Well, the ICC Global Trade Finance Survey is a survey conducted by, led by the ICC Banking Commission, but in partnership with the major stakeholders with international trade. So the World Trade Organization, all the development banks, and EBRD was a founding partner in the ICC Market Intelligence Group. We have the Bern Union of Credit Insurers. We have also the World Trade Organization, the World Bank, and of course now our latest partner is the International Monetary Fund. So we have the key players participating together to gather intelligence on what's happening in the marketplace. Why do we need information? Why is it so important? Going back to the financial crisis in last quarter 2008, there was a lack of information of the impact on the financial crisis on trade, though the pain was being felt around the world. Pascal Lamy, Director General of Trade, requested the ICC Banking Commission to take the lead and do a global trade finance survey, and now what we're looking at is our latest global trade finance survey. Our survey is acknowledged to have contributed to the creation of a fund of approximately 250 billion supports for trade, which has had some positive impact on keeping trade lines open. When you read our survey, you will see there is an introduction by major leaders in international trade and finance. We have Kai Chai Tan, who's head of trade at Barclays, also chair of the ICC Banking Commission, Daniel Cotty, head of trade at JP Morgan, John Ahern from head of trade at Citibank, and Daniel Shamand of Deutsche Bank. I won't give you exactly what they said, but let me just tell you that in summary, they're saying that they are, well, last year our heads of trade said they were cautiously optimistic. I was told during this presentation last week not to use the same word, cautiously optimistic. So I'm going to say they're all optimistically cautious, okay? I can't go too far wrong. But I want to add another word right now, cautiously optimistic, optimistically cautious, but very fragile. The trade finance environment right now, from our survey, is fragile. There are lots of issues, lots of problems, and I'm going to give you some of the facts and figures. The facts and figures were gleaned from banks. 229 banks responded to our survey, and we had respondents from 110 countries. So that is a very global perspective on what's happening in world trade. We did global representation, but thankfully to the support of Rudolph at Camola and their team, we had very large response from the EBRD countries of operation. What are the key issues? Well, to understand our story, we need to go back to last quarter 2008. September 2008, when basically we had the financial crisis following the collapse of Lehman Brothers. In that period of time, trade went into free fall. Trade actually collapsed. The first time in modern day's history did trade actually go into decline. But not just decline, it went into collapse. And one of the reasons was a lack of trade finance, trade capacity in the marketplace. When we fast forward a little bit in our up-to-date survey, we actually see that from the collapse in trade, there has been a pretty okay recovery in trade. But actually, news that is not so good is that at the end of last year, trade started to go into decline again. And this was very worrying because the trade was seen to be in decline from emerging markets. And up until the end of last year, where we had growth in trade and where trade was being sustained, it was by the emerging growing markets and not the advanced economies. So starting off this year, the trend is not looking very positive. When we look at trade finance itself and some of the issues regarding the marketplace, for our survey this year, which covers 2011, actually we start with what, as trade bankers, we could say is good news. And the good news is that this year's survey, compared to the previous year, 80% of our respondents, 80%, a big increase, reported an increase in trade finance activity with their customers. Two reasons. Number one, customers are looking for security. But number two, banks are finding they can finance their customers using trade finance where other cash liquid credit lines are drying up. It reflects what's happening in the market. Talking about risk, 69, almost 70% of respondents reported an increase in demand for confirmations under letters of credit in particular. Again, this reflects not increased trade activity, but increased risk perspective, where parties are looking to offload the risk as best they can with their counterparties. Again, we saw on EBRD's own facts and figures, their request for confirmations has also increased dramatically, so all the information remains consistent. Many of our bankers around the world reported a new issue, and that is that within their own banks, due to regulatory requirements, a new problem has arisen, and that is internal competition within the bank for allocation of credit lines. So for trade finance, we're having to fight for what we can get to support our customers' needs within a bank. When we look at fees, our current survey reported that there was no dramatic increase in fees for trade finance instruments last year. The previous year there was a dramatic increase, but you know, my own belief is this is going to be short-lived and we are going to see pretty significant increases in fees. Other trade finance issues that are of importance. 60% of our respondents reported that there had been no improvement in the level of discrepancies in documents being refused by banks. The previous year we reported like a disaster that the rate of refusals had gone up dramatically. Well, I must say it hasn't really gone up, but it hasn't got any better. 60% are saying it hasn't got any better. Standby letters of credit and guarantees. Again, an increase in demands and claims. Again, underlying the fact that there are underlying defaults in trade finance transactions. 51% reported an increase under guarantees and standby letters of credit. Other things that are appearing on our screen, 57% reported increasing claims under standbys and guarantees. Other issues appearing on the screen are 30% of respondents. 30% of respondents reported an increase in the number of court injunctions stopping payment under a trade finance instrument. So in a local issuing bank's country, the importer and now sometimes the bank goes to a court and requests a stop order on payment. Of course, this has serious consequences from confirming banks, confirming letters of credit. Also, not so new, but they're becoming very hot topics in this year's survey. Last year, they were mentioned by a few, but this year, nearly everybody. Impact of economic sanctions and sanctions clauses in commercial letters of credit, now becoming a key issue. Know your customer issues following directly on for this. So we have a challenging trade environment. When we want facts and figures on trends in trade, it's hard to get them. But one place we can get them that we can rely them on because they're facts and figures is the SWIFT network. So within our survey, we have a very comprehensive report from SWIFT, but I'm only going to give you some of the key facts and figures. Overall growth in SWIFT traffic last year grew by 5.81%, which looks encouraging. But in trade, for the first time, we had a drop. We had a significant decline. A significant decline of 2.23%. Now that's significant because for the years before it was always growing by 5 or 6%. So last year, drop of 2.3%. When we look at the categories of messages, it's trade messaging, of course. Category 7 for letters of credit, standbys and guarantees, and of course collections. But of particular importance, letters of credit, commercial letters of credit, down by about 1.25%. Not such a big amount, but when it's a trend that never was down before, we need to pay attention and we need to look at these figures a little bit more carefully. When we look at the perspective for trade messaging at the end of this year and into this year, into the beginning of this year, again it was negative. Looking forward, looking negative, we again, is not very encouraging because these are real facts and figures. We can see this at the end of the screen there. Okay. But so people don't get too nervous. We can actually see that the SWIFT messaging for trade is still higher than 2008. It's significantly higher than 2009. So while we have a drop and a trend we need to worry about, there is no collapse like we had in 2008. When we look at regional patterns for trade messaging, it's very interesting. When we look at SWIFT trade traffic sent by region, we actually see in Asia Pacific. Now sent means messages sent. Import letters of credit sent, imports. So on the import side, we see an increase of 0.97%. So basically on the import side from Asia, an increase of about 1%. Not dramatic, but at least it's encouraging. But then when we look at Europe, we're down by 5.25%, and most other areas of the world, particularly the advanced markets, are showing a downward trend, reflecting the underlying economic situation in these particular markets. Where have we seen increases in Swift messaging? Well, here they are. Romania up by 34%. And people again say, this is very interesting. And it's interesting because Romania was a market that had moved significantly out of traditional trade finance instruments, but now is moving back, given the situation we're experiencing in the international markets. There is some good news, actually. There's Sri Lanka, and I was in Sri Lanka recently. Their messaging is increasing, but thankfully it's due to their country has stabilized, and they're actually experiencing an economic boom at the moment. When we look at the countries with the largest decreases, well, we see Iran at the top, okay? And of course, this is no surprise, down by 19%. And with what has happened in the recent weeks with Swift making announcement, we're going to see this basically drop an awful lot faster, an awful lot quicker, which I personally believe is the wrong approach. Again, no surprise there to see Egypt here, and also, of course, we have what's happening in Europe, Spain as well, reflected in the figures. When we look at Swift traffic received by region, okay, Asia Pacific now is interesting because for the first time we're seeing a decline. Messaging received, this means export letters of credit, in particular Southeast Asia, in particular China, and including India, but especially China, we're seeing a decline, reflecting a fact that even China is experiencing challenges in their export development and earning revenue from exports, and I guess that's why they're beginning to concentrate on stimulating the local economy. Again, in advanced markets for exports, declined by over 5%. These are trends we need to be aware of. One thing that is actually of significant interest is the importance of the development of inter-regional trade. Now, this very colourful slide is very confusing, and it confuses me, the heck out of me as well. But one thing you can see, where I have these circles, here we have Asia Pacific, that means the importance of inter-regional trade. So inter-regional trade is becoming really important, as supported by the facts and figures, and you can actually see it here for the Middle Eastern countries. Swift messaging inter-regionally is actually on the increase, whereas externally, actually on the decreasing trend. When we look at Swift messaging for trade, again, it's interesting to note that despite all the countries in the world, all the countries trading with their own individual country, on Swift messaging now, Swift are giving us values as well as volumes. So it's very interesting to see that 83% of Swift messages issued were denominated in the US dollar. 83%. Now that's significantly higher than I would have anticipated. But actually, this figure is lower than the previous year because there are new currencies developing for international trade. The Chinese RMB has started slowly but surely and is growing in use. Last week at the EBRD conference in London, I was quite surprised, though I shouldn't be because I'm active in these markets, that the Russian ruble is beginning to gather speed in use for inter-regional trade between Russia and the other CIS countries. This has been going on, but now, due to the situation in Europe and concerns about other currencies, we see changing trends, changing patterns in international trade. Average value of a Swift letter of credit, $630,000, but I'm not really so sure how interesting that really is. But maybe it points that, you know, a lot of these letters of credit are geared towards a smaller business than we think in the multi-million that we like to talk about when we have a problem. They do support smaller business, smaller trade. Section 4 of our report has a very interesting summary of the work of the development banks. The work that has been pioneered by the EBRD, and as we heard, has been followed on by the other development banks into a global network of development banks. All of the development banks, which is good news, without exemption, increased their resources in 2011. As other commercial banks cut their limits and brought resources back home, EBRD did exactly the opposite. They move forward to provide risk coverage in markets where it was really needed to keep supply chains open. This lead was followed by the other development banks. Lots of interesting facts and figures, but one I want to highlight is that between the development banks, they have covered more than $40 billion worth of trade. ADB has had no losses, no claims. IDB, no claims, no losses. IFC, no claims, no losses. EBRD has had a small number of claims, but these have been restructured. As of today, no losses. What's the message? The message is that trade, if it is done right, with the right procedures, the right knowledge, and understanding the needs of the customer, is actually low-risk business. But to do it low-risk, you need to do it right. When we look at credit insurance, and I know I'm going on a little bit, but this information is useful. Information from the Bern Union of Credit Insurers tells us that in the last few years, export credit insurance has grown dramatically. Short-term export credit insurance grew by 25% in 2011. Medium to long-term up by 10%. Short-term up by 25%. This short-term business is fundamentally open account business. So when we talk about open account, we must remember that people are moving to cover the risk, whether that's going to be in credit insurance or using a standby letter of credit. The operation will appear in open account, but there is a background coverage. All increased. Okay. 1.5 trillion covered by the Bern Union last year, and actually it was interesting that I think it's 1.5 trillion was short term, and only 200 billion was actually medium term. So there's a little hidden story there. Short term business is moving, and is moving pretty well, but on the medium term business, it's getting really challenging to fund medium term business. Medium term means investment in machinery, capital equipment, goods that are needed to grow economies. So this is something that regulators and policy people need to actually take on board. Finally, credit insurance. Words of warning or caution from the Bern Union. In the first quarter of 2011, claims paid stood at $217 million. From high numbers, this was going back to kind of typical market conditions, still a little bit high, still a little bit higher than we would like, but pretty standard. But what was actually interesting and really not a positive indicator is last quarter we saw the claims paid go up to 471 million. That's twice what was paid in the first quarter, so we will be looking with a lot of interest in what happens next. Finally, I just want to give you some facts and figures. ICC, in partnership with development banks, but also major commercial banks, have initiated a project called the ICC Trade Register. What is the purpose? The purpose is to make a case that trade, if done correctly, is low risk. Genuine trade is low risk. So what we have done is we have gathered data to demonstrate to the Basel Committee and other regulators the low risk profile of trade. So what data have we actually gathered? We've gathered data on the main trade products you see here, letters of credit, guarantees, bonds, and also trade-related loans. I don't need to go through them all. What have we found? Well, basically, the findings have been pretty interesting. Oh, wait. Okay, sorry. Bear with me. From the reporting period of 2007 to 2010, we gathered information of 5.2 million transactions. Of 5.2 million trade transactions, there was only 947 defaults. But actually, we have a current challenge with the regulators right now that want us to give them an exact definition of what is a default. And actually, that is something interesting we might talk about later in our next presentation. But for example, if we look at import letters of credit, default rate of 0.077%, incredibly low. Losses also even lower, 0.007%. So again, underlying the low-risk nature of trade. The ICC Banking Commission is very happy to work in partnership with the EBRD. We are very happy to work in partnership with banks in Jordan, and in fact, of some of our committees for guarantees, standby letters of credit, some of the top experts we have are regarded in the ICC Banking Commission come from Jordan, more than one person. So we're really pleased to work with you. And so much so that as part of this process, our next Banking Commission meeting is in Mexico City on the 12th to the 16th of November, and this is my marketing, okay? You're all invited to attend, and you all will be getting a copy of the report. So thank you very much for your valuable time, greatly appreciated. Thank you.